Okay, my friends, we're going to go ahead and get started and with our time together, because I am so looking forward. Our guest lecturer today is Mr. Bill Cotter. He's a historian and author. Bill has had a longtime fascination with Disney television. One of his earliest childhood memories is watching the Mickey Mouse Club with his younger brother, saying it was probably one of the few times they were so quiet together. Years of watching the weekly anthology series eventually led to his working at the studio in Burbank, where he met his wife, Carol, on a soundstage, as well as at Disneyland, Walt Disney World, and WED, or now Imagineering. During his time at Disney, he co-founded an employees club to showcase the company's old television shows, to educate others on this aspect of Disney history, but also in reality, so he could see them again himself. Bill later left for another film studio, but his ongoing research into Disney's television history made him a semi-permanent resident of the Disney archives, culminating in his 1997 book, The Wonderful World of Disney Television. A key contributor to the 40 Years of Disney Television Magic special, aired in 1994, Bill has been featured on several Disney DVDs and documentaries, and has shared his love of Disney television at fan conventions, including two D23 events, which are amazing events. Most recently, he appeared in several episodes of the Disney Plus series, Behind the Attraction. And in his spare time, he has written 13 books on World's Fairs, was recently named the Volunteer of the Year for the LA Police Department, and also keeps busy with Boy Scouts, where he was just selected into the Eagle Scout Hall of Fame. So, Bill, welcome to the Emeritus Institute. Thank you so much, and take it away.
Well, thank you. I really appreciate being here. Feel honored to spend some time with you. I have a presentation put together, and just for background on it, we were working on the movie Tomorrowland, some of you may recall, with George Clooney. And I was with Becky Klein, the Disney archivist, and we were talking about how so many people at the Disney company didn't know about Disney's interaction with World's Fairs. You get to my age with the gray hair and everything, you start realizing that the younger people live in a different world or different mindset. And what's commonplace to us was not as commonplace to them. And Becky and I were talking about how the 64 World's Fair, shown behind me, the Unisphere, people may remember from Men in Black, was a really major milestone for the Disney company. And we were saying if it hadn't been for the World's Fair, there probably wouldn't be a Walt Disney World. And without Walt Disney World, would there be a Disney company today? Because back in the 60s, Disney was a really minor player. I started working there in 1976, and it was definitely by far the smallest of the film studios. Of course, now, you know, things have really changed. But they asked me to put together a presentation that was shown. I did it live at the studio at Disneyland, the Disney studios rather, in Burbank. And then it was streamed out to all the Disney facilities worldwide. So that's the basis of the talk I'm going to be giving today. I've added a few things that have been discovered since then. But let me go and bring up the screen here, and I will get started. I'll be right with you. Okay, so hopefully folks can see it there. And let me go to the presentation mode. Come here. Okay, technology is wonderful. So I'm going to be talking about Disney and the World's Fairs, a little history of how Disney got into it. And again, just for some background information, it was mentioned where I went to work for Disney. I had been working as a computer designer on nuclear submarines, and we were doing a test at Port Canaveral, Florida. And the other guys, we had a day off we weren't planning on, and everybody else went over to Disney World to go play golf. I went over to Disney for something to do, and I walked in. It was like being back at the 64 World's Fair. I had gone to the 64 Fair a lot. I had an uncle who worked on it. I had a friend's sister who could get us in for free because she worked there. So I went to the World's Fair a lot, 64 and 65, and then pretty much, you know, out of sight, out of mind. But going into the front gate of Disney World, it was like being back at the 64 Fair. There was Mr. Lincoln. There was the Carousel of Progress. It was just all sorts of stuff I remembered. So I went in to the gift shop, bought a tie, went to what we call the casting office, asked for a job, and I went to program the Country Bears and other things like that. Disney at that time was just getting into computerized stuff, and I got hired on to be the company's one and only computer security guy. And I had two mandates: nobody steals from the company using a computer, and nobody gets hurt on a ride controlled by a computer. So I was supposed to work in Florida, and the way things go, Disney decided the job's in California. So here's a picture of my brand new 1976 Camaro, still with the New York license plate, parked on Main Street as I got out here. And it, as I mentioned in the introduction, I had a great job. I'd spent a month at this studio, a month at Disneyland, a month at Disney World, off to Imagineering, and just did that for a whole bunch of years. Well, we're going to start going into the World's Fair piece of it here back in 1933, Chicago. Walt's father had worked on the big World's Fair in 1898, I think it was Chicago, but there's no proof that Walt ever went to that fair. So the history really starts back here in 33. This was the Hollywood Pavilion, and you'll see a sign about animated movie cartoons in the making. It's interesting, the Disney archives today is the most impressive of all the studio archives. They've really done a wonderful job. But back in the days of 33, 34, nobody was thinking about saving stuff for the future. So Disney doesn't have anything about what they did at this particular show. We believe it was somebody doing animation type sketches and, you know, giving away pictures, you know, to the attendees. All we know about it is that they had a display, and that in between the seasons of the 33-34 fair, it was moved to a department store, and you could go to the department store and still see the promotions for Disney films being made. So it's a sort of fun thing for an archivist, where, you know, at first we didn't know anything about it, then a picture comes up, then you find a newspaper article, you keep digging in more. So hopefully we'll find more in it someday, and things do turn up. It is fun what does show up. This is an example. Again, what was Disney doing at the fair? People weren't sure. They knew that Disney had something at the fair, but there wasn't a lot of correspondence or history on it. And I was restoring pictures from my collection, came across this one, and we'll zoom in. And there's the first Disney store, the Mickey Shop. And the children's theater next to it would show Disney cartoons. In the shop, they would sell Disney merchandise, and it became very interesting because I'll get to some of the merchandise in a second. You can see that they also put up Mickey and Minnie characters, and I get that's supposed to be Pluto for a meet and greet thing where you can get your picture taken on board. But one of the big things they did was they had the Mickey Mouse watch. And you would go to the Ingersoll Pavilion, and they would actually be making watches in front of you, and then they would put them in a box and sell them. And this was a big thing. It kept the Ingersoll Company from going bankrupt. They made a lot of money on the watches. And I don't know enough to be able to tell the differences, but the 1933-34 watches made at the fair came with a slightly different twist. I think the box was slightly different than the ones you would go buy in your local department store.
So sorry. One more moment. There seems to be two boxes on the screen. Are those the Zoom boxes? If you can.
Yeah, there's a way to make that go away. And I'm trying to remember, maybe I can just slide it off to another monitor or something.
Yes.
Okay, hang on here. That work?
Yeah, there, one's gone, and then you have one more. There you go. Perfect. Thank you so much.
Okay, great.
Apologize. Thanks. Thank you.
Oh, no problem. Glad to do it. I don't know if I'll ever get that screen back again, but the heck with it. So find it, look for it later. So the watches became really popular, and they did not say anything on them about the World's Fair, but there is some hidden detail that if you're a watch collector, you'll know. Now, one of the things you have to be careful about are some things are fake. There's so much money to be made in Disney merchandise that a number of years ago, somebody went off and started selling these pocket knives. Not sold at the 33 World's Fair. Matter of fact, we believe these were pretty much mass-produced overseas in the 60s, just as the Disneyana convention came out. So if you get one of these, it's a nice knife to have, but unfortunately, it's a bootleg. We skip up to the 1939-1940 New York World's Fair. This was a huge event held in New York. By gold standards, it's considered to be the World's Fair by many, many people for the architecture, the design, that sort of thing. The theme structure was the trilon and perisphere, the triangular building and the dome there in the center. We'll be coming back to the perisphere and its Disney influence later on. But it was a great fair. You could go out to ride the parachute ride if you're in the New York area. If you go to Coney Island, it still stands there today, no longer a ride, but it's lit up at night, a great icon. You had robots there were telling you about the future, the sort of thing you later with Disney with the Carousel of Progress, all talk of the future. And you had steam trains. This is one we get a kick out of for those of us that worked at Imagineering. Was this steam train actually sat on a set of rollers and they would get it up to full pressure, full steam, and start driving it down the rollers. And you can see people walking by the clouds of live steam. And you keep thinking, what if the roller ever stuck and the train came off? So we joke sometimes in, Imagineering about, the things you could do back then that you would never, ever, ever think about doing today. But it was a beautiful fair, generated a lot of people. And again, there's the parachute jump you can go see today. And Disney had a presence at the World's Fair. It was their first World's Fair exhibit on the East Coast, and basically the first Walt experience had with doing a World's Fair show that we have documentation on. Again, we know he did something in Chicago. We don't have a lot. But he did this cartoon for Nabisco, and they had all their various products that were held out here. It was also shown at the 1939-1940 San Francisco World's Fair, which I'll show more in a moment, was held at the same time. So they were very proud of the fact that they actually premiered the fair the film at their fair, because it opened early in the year than the New York one did. But this was the big thing Disney did here was he made this special cartoon, Mickey and Minnie and all his characters, as an ad. And some people say it's the first ad he did, and that's not really true. Walt had gotten in the animation business doing ads for movie theaters for his local dentist, an animal doctor, other odds and ends. But this one was a full Technicolor production. It was really done with a lot of time and effort. World's Fair ended. You can see it's starting to come to, it was only supposed to last 2 years, and it's starting to come to pieces. And when they tore it down, the World's Fair ran out of money. They didn't have the money to tear out the grounds. So all these empty scarred areas where things used to be, that round circle up top was the Trilon and Perisphere. And the fairgrounds left pretty dismal. In the 50s, it was looking pretty nasty. And I would just ask you to park this in your memory so that they did a World's Fair, it didn't make money, and they left this kind of ruin behind. And that's the ruin is a big reason Disney got back into it to help him fix it later on. So he was still at the Golden Gate International Exposition, a big World's Fair on a man-made island, Treasure Island, out in the San Francisco Harbor area. And at that one, he had the movie, the Mickey Mouse movie, but they also did a thing here, Mickey and Donald's Race to Treasure Island. And you would go to your Standard Oil Company dealer and, try to convince Dad to buy the right amount of gallons of gasoline. And you would get a stamp to put on your map, and there would be a little tale that you could follow. And on the backside, really great artwork. Hank Porter, artist that did a lot of the work for Disney for the Saturday Evening Post pages, did this really great story about how Mickey and Donald and the nephews go out to visit the World's Fair. So these are highly sought after by collectors. Very, very few of them have the whole set of stamps on it that most of them gave up over time or they've been lost. So World's Fairs stopped. World War II came along, and they hadn't been in World's Fair for a while. And then Expo 58 in Brussels was the first post-World War II fair. The Cold War in huge, huge swing at that time. So the United States and the Soviet Union were basically across the street from each other. The United States built this building here, a very large building with a kind of interesting construction design that gave a tremendous amount of interior space. And then they realized they had a problem. They spent all the money on the building, and they had next to nothing to put inside for displays. So they had announced all sorts of grand things, a simulated Hollywood visit, and everything had to be really toned back. And they turned to Walt Disney for help. And look to the left of the main building, and you're going to see a little tiny little round building over there. We'll take a closer look. That was Circarama. If you've been to the Disney parks, you're familiar with the 360-degree movies. Well, that was designed and built for the Expo 58 in Brussels. They basically, it was the name was not accidental, Circarama. They took a car, they put, I think it was at that time, 6 movie cameras up on top of the car, station wagon, drove it around, and took pictures of the United States that they edited into this movie. It became a huge hit, a monumental hit for Disney and for the fair. The idea of being in an immersive environment where you're inside the theater and everywhere you look, there was a movie around you, was something really spectacular. Hollywood was experimenting at this time with all sorts of things. So you have, Panavision was bigger than, some other studios thing. You had the Circle, the Cinerama, all sorts of big things, but nobody went more than 360 degrees. So Circarama was a big thing. And it also became a big thing for Disney because they put it in Disneyland at America the Beautiful. And if you talk to folks from Disney, you might hear an acronym come up from time to time of OPM. And OPM stands for Other People's Money. So how do you get an attraction and how do you get it built? And if you can get it built with OPM, so much the better. So you have Circarama, you want to go in and take advantage of it and you want to put it into Disneyland. So what do? You convince the Bell System to sponsor the film America the Beautiful. And Disney has been very successful with OPM over the years. And this film, America the Beautiful, ran for many, many years and was updated and went from 6 cameras to 8 cameras to give it more definition in that. But it was a huge, huge success. And it proved to Disney that if you do a World's Fair show, there can be life for it afterwards. 1962 Seattle World's Fair, Disney did not have much of a presence. We're going to see some of it because he was very busy at this point in time. He had agreed to do the work for the Olympics in Squaw Valley and had dedicated a lot of his extra staff capacity to coming up with the opening and closing ceremonies for it and all. But Walt did go to the fair. There's Walt and his wife Lillian. Off to the side, the tall fellow carrying the baby is Ron Miller, and just off to his side is Diane Disney Miller. There's their kids, and then over on the other side are the fair executives, the president of the fair, inviting Walt out. So Walt and his family spent a vacation at the fair, and he came back with a lot of observations on what to do, and also particularly what not to do. And he had given them some consulting, some free advice, based on crowd control experiences at Disneyland, but he didn't have a formal pavilion. They did have an exhibit over at the Bell System. Again, he had a long, long time relationship with the Bell System, and they put in a pavilion where you could pick up the phone, dial a number, and you could talk to a Disney character. So if you dial number 1, you might be speaking to Snow White. If you dial 7, Jiminy Cricket sort of thing. And they were all pre-recorded announcements, hi, this is your pal Jiminy Cricket. How are you today? Are you having fun? Pause. Oh, that's good. I'm glad to hear it. That sort of thing. Not anything computer-driven, interactive or anything, but it was great fun for kids. They later, again, using other people's money, you take this exhibit out of the 62 World's Fair and you stick it in the after-show area at Disneyland. So after you came and you saw the film, now you came out and you could, again, call the Disney characters and talk to them. Disney has been very famous for synergy, that if there's more than one way to skin a cat, Disney knows how to do that. So this is Walt Disney's Comics and Stories that came out in 1962, and Donald and his nephews go to the Duckburg World's Fair. And you can see something that looks sort of like the Space Needle in the background there and some other fanciful pavilions. I won't show you the whole comic, but safe to say at the end of it, the Space Needle is not standing and Donald has really made a mess of things. So we come along to the fair that changed everything. I mentioned the fairgrounds had been left pretty much a ruin from 1939 World's Fair. The newspapers ran articles of from time to time, where once there was magic, now there's only rats running through the grounds. And Robert Moses was the head of the park commission in New York City, and they were very interested in trying to come up with a way to raise the money to finally build Flushing Meadows Park into the park that had long been planned. There was a lot of competition going on in the 50s to do a World's Fair, because it had been the Brussels World's Fair was much, much more successful than anticipated. So the city of Baltimore wanted a World's Fair, Chicago wanted a World's Fair, New York wanted a World's Fair, and all these people were going back and trying to get a World's Fair. And you can't obviously have multiple World's Fairs like that at the same time. So President Eisenhower looked at all the proposals, and he decided that New York was going to get the World's Fair, and announced in 1959 that they were going to do it in New York. So it was a big thing. Sorry, the dogs are reacting to somebody at the door. Robert Moses, if you're from New York, you either love him or hate him. He built an amazing number of bridges and tunnels and parkways and beaches and city parks. But he also destroyed a number of neighborhoods to do that. So if you were the beneficiary of going to, say, Jones Beach, which is a beautiful beach on Long Island, you liked Robert Moses. If you were in the Bronx and he had put a highway right through your ancestral home, you probably didn't like him so much. But he was a mover and shaker, and he got things done, and he got named to head the World's Fair. And this is an interesting quote I'll let you read here. Walt got interested in the fair. He heard about it, and he had been thinking, you know, Disneyland was doing pretty well. Could he expand to the East Coast? But he was always worried that, as he said, his small town sense of values, would that translate to the big city? You know, and it's interesting, you know, I think of LA as a big city, but Walt was always kind of intimidated by New York, it seems, the big money back there and the big Wall Street crowd and everything like that. So he starts thinking about the World's Fair, and down at the bottom, he said, we'll be getting new attractions for Disneyland too. And we'll be getting shows that will go on maybe 5 to 10 years at Disneyland. And you think about stuff like Small World, these shows have been there a lot longer. So Walt got many things right. And this one, he was a little less than right, because they ran for much, much longer than he thought. So Moses, again, he's a real mover and shaker. But he didn't play well with others. And one of the big mistakes Moses made was that World's Fairs are chartered by a group called the Bureau of International Expositions in Paris. And they have all sorts of rules that fairs can run for exactly 6 months, not a day longer. You can't charge rent to the international participants, all sorts of odds and ends. Or they can also be near within 5 years of another fair. And keep in mind, Seattle had just had one in 62. So the BIE turned down Robert Moses' bid to have an official sanctioned World's Fair. And they went so far as to tell their member nations, if you participate in the New York Fair, you probably will never get an official World's Fair for your country. So now Moses has this big problem. He's got a World's Fair, and the world is not coming to it. And some of the nations got around it. If you went to the Japan Pavilion at the 64 World's Fair, there was a Japan Pavilion, there was a number of nations. But they were run by Japanese companies that were exhibiting there, not the Japanese government. So Moses contacted Walt, who was interested in the World's Fair, and he basically said, I will give you basically any plot of land you have, anything you want to do, just come here and help me find stuff and build it. So this is them in the model planning room, the fairground site laid out. A lot of the infrastructure was previously determined by the 39 World's Fair, where the streets would be, where the fountains would be, that sort of thing. But Walt was given carte blanche to come up with stuff. Sounds great, but now Walt had to come up with, again, other people's money, because the Disney company just did not have the money to build the sort of exhibits that we're going to go see. So these are the exhibits he did. They became some of the top exhibits in terms of audience participation. Number one at the top of the list was General Motors Futurama, not a non-Disney show. But Disney had the Carousel of Progress done by General Electric. Pepsi's Small World, State of Illinois, had great moments with Mr. Lincoln. And Ford, moments in time, driving back to see the dinosaurs. So take a
see
look
the future
here.
First at the New York World's Fair. Your visit will be a vacation. an education, an inspiration. Wonder at
no,
the
I'm not seeing the video.
See colonies on the moon and at the bottom of the sea.
Thrill now? To
four now it is. Thank you.
By Walt Disney, especially for the fair. It's a small world. Ford's Magic Skyway. Great moments with Mr. Lincoln and General Electric's Carousel of Progress. Here to tell you about it is Walt Disney.
Here, for example, is a scale model of the General Electric Carousel Theater. A theater in which the audience itself moves in their seats around the stages. The actors, well, they're not real people, but they are a talented and interesting cast. We call them audio animatronic figures, and they talk and act like human beings. Work in this new type of animation is going on around the clock to meet the opening date of the fair.
Here, humanity's arts and ideas, products and progress will be gathered in a fantasia of friendship and hope. Take a trip to the moon and beyond as you are propelled from the outer reaches of space back to Earth and into the center of the tiniest atom. Narrated by Rod Serling and presented in stereophonic sound and 70mm Spacearium 360 by Cinerama on our 80-foot domed screen, only at the New York World's Fair.
See you at the fair, and remember,
there's a great big beautiful tomorrow. Shining at the end of every day, there's a great big beautiful tomorrow, just a dream away.
And that film is a little bit of a cheat because it was not done at the time of the World's Fair. It was part of the marketing campaign we did for the movie Tomorrowland, taking current footage, old footage, putting it together. They did a whole guerrilla marketing thing about if you saw the movie, there was a society of super intellects, and they had planned out this utopian world of the future. So they started planting all sorts of things around on internet sites about newly discovered secrets, and you got to go see the story in Tomorrowland. That was a trailer put together for it. Walt had been real interested for many years about doing a show called One Nation Under God. He was a big fan of Abraham Lincoln. He had actually played Abraham Lincoln in a school play. There's a picture you can see of Walt in a homemade stovepipe hat with a beard glued to him. And he had been trying for years and years and years to get companies interested in doing this, but not having a lot of luck at it because it turned out to be a very expensive show. So the story for this all begins way back at Disneyland, well before the World's Fair, where he was trying to have an area, two areas that never got to be built, one called Liberty Street and Edison Square. To orient yourself, the main street is at the far left of the picture here. A lot of the shops have changed names, but you can recognize the Main Street Cinema there, and then going up the street, the castle would be up above the top of it. So he wanted to do Liberty Square Street, which is going to be a salute to colonial America, and then Edison Square about how electricity had changed the world we live in today. And it was going to be coming. He was always announcing these things were coming. So first it was going to be International Street. It was going to be a little tour of famous places around the world. And it's coming in 56. It's coming in 57. No, we're going to do Liberty Street. It's going to be 58. No, it's coming in 59. And I like to joke, whoever the Disneyland construction company was, they were good at putting up signs, but they never got those streets built. Did all sorts of artwork, and it's, you know, Disney's very full circle. They saved basically everything. So a lot of the things that were planned for Liberty Street became part of Liberty Square at Walt Disney World. And he thought, hey, I can get other people's money again to try to sell this. Monsanto had been a longtime sponsor at Disneyland. They did the Hall of Chemistry. And they had the House of the Future there. And they went to Monsanto. You'd like to sponsor a thing on American history, wouldn't you? And Monsanto said, no. The Hall of Chemistry is great because we bring people in and we tell them how chemicals and products and everything we make are going to make your life better. The House of the Future was great because we were going to try to convince everybody for prefab plastic houses were going to be great. But a show in American history doesn't seem to help us sell anything for the world of chemistry. So we're going to pass on it. So he said, okay, I'll go to General Motors. General Motors, you'd like me to do the show for you. And I mentioned earlier, General Motors was the number one hit of the 39 World's Fair. Futurama, the big pavilion in the center there was a ride through how cities were going to be a master plan with two-lane highways, local traffic down below, everybody on express lanes up above. It was a huge show, and Walt went to them and they said, thanks, but no thanks. And he gave a really nice presentation by all accounts, but they said, we have our own design staff working on it. And then something really weird happened, something that would never, ever happen in today's business world. They said, why don't you go talk to the guys at Ford? You know, and today it'd be unthinkable. I mean, you could imagine the guys from Apple saying, hey, go talk to the guys that make Android phones. It just doesn't happen. But Ford had basically a big problem. They didn't know what they were going to do with their exhibit. They had skipped the 1933 season of the World's Chicago World's Fair. Henry Ford was not a believer in World's Fairs and that. And he saw how much the competition sold more cars that year than he did. So he went into the 34 season of the World's Fair with three pavilions at it. And on the left side, you can just see a car passing a street light. They had a section of road built that was simulating roads of the world. And they had cobblestone streets, roads with planks, paved roads and that. And Ford drivers would take you around and show you just how well a Ford car handled on all these road conditions. That dome-shaped thing in the back is a Ford stage where they did concerts and that. So Ford had seen huge sale bump in 34 over 33. So they knew they wanted to get into the World's Fair, but they didn't know what to do. And they, by the time GM suggested to Disney, Ford had hired and fired 11 different design companies to come up with concepts for the World's Fair. And they said, okay, yeah, if you got one, we're willing to listen, because time's running out. It takes time to design and build these things. Their mandate was it had to have cars in it. And again, they did the same thing for the 39 World's Fair, where they put you in a Ford car. So that was their mandate. Come up with a car, a show, where people are going to be in cars. So Walt and his team came up with an idea here where they're going to put people inside of a Ford pavilion. And he didn't want to do what Ford did with live drivers, because he figured he wanted to carefully control the environment. He wanted the show inside. He didn't, because again, New York weather can be unpredictable, rain and that sort of stuff. And he didn't want the drivers giving the narration, because he wanted this to be a show. So he designed this huge building where you would get in Ford cars and you would drive through them and you would go through the seven wonders of the world, which as one memo said, and they can be whatever wonders we decide they are. So in the top picture, you can see they're driving through desert scenes, and you have some stuff that looks like Montezuma's castle or ruins up in the side. Down below, you have the Everglades, and you have bobcats, and you got coyotes, and you got all sorts of stuff. It was a really ambitious project, and it frankly was too ambitious. And this is one of the things that killed it. This was their estimate in 1961 of how many animals it would take to do that particular ride. So if you look at it, you know, for the Florida Everglades alone, it was 67 figures just there, 86 of them for the Grand Canyon. And they just said, there's no way we can come up with the amount of money it's going to take to build all these things. Ford just can't afford it. So they went back to the drawing board. We can't have, you know, 150 characters, you know, small little things like roadrunners and coyotes. Maybe we can get half a dozen big ones. So they went back and came up with the idea of, rather than driving through the seven wonders of the world, let's go back to prehistoric time and start showing how the transportation has evolved from the early days of the wheel up to the days of the super modern air conditions, you know, radio equipped Ford you're sitting in today. So they came up with the ideas of dinosaurs and sketched it all out. There were a couple concepts that they came up with that, that were not done. For example, the T-Rex in the bottom right attacking the car would look perfectly at home if this was a storyboard for a Jurassic Park movie. But they came up with the ideas, the sketches. Ford said, yep, sounds good. Start building it and off you go. And they next went to another technique. Basically, a lot of these shows were designed using movie making techniques. Before you build a very super expensive movie set, you build a small model of it. And you can, now it's all done with computers and stuff. But back then you'd make a model. The director could then start figuring out sight lines and lighting angles and that. So they built the entire thing on tabletops on side one of the sound stages, and they could get down and envision, if I was in the car at the driver's seat, what would I be seeing? So they had the little model, and then they had timer things marked out that at the 1 minute and 30 second mark, you'll be here. 2 minutes and 10 seconds will be here. So they could start trying to figure out the timing, the narration for it. So this particular one shows an interesting technique that they had. Because they went into the cars, but Walt didn't want gas motor them. So they had it inside the building, and they had to drive the car without Ford employees driving. There's John Hench there, who's a master artist at the after genius underneath the car. This was built in the back lot of the Disney studio, pretty close to where they shot the Burrow series. They had this pinion system that follows around the track. The little wheels you see off the left side are rotating with motors, and they basically just pull the car through the system by the rotors down at the bottom of the track. So they built this small system, and they also had to work up this L system that they could walk up to the car, walk at the same speed as the car, get in the car, and go off the road to the main building. So they got the okay from Ford. The fellow named Bob Gurr, if you're a Disney historian or enthusiast, the name Bob Gurr is synonymous with anything at Disneyland that moved. The Main Street vehicles, the monorails, just anything with a motor in it, Bob Gurr came up with. So after that first little track, they built another one because they had to see how the cars would do on a track that had different levels, because the building was going to have several different levels to make maximum use of the space. And so these wheels would, again, turn with the platen, the metal plate on the bottom of the car. And they realized they had some problems with it again, because if a car was full of people, it weighed more than a car without people. Different cars had bigger engines. Different cars had different drivetrains. So what they ended up doing was taking out all the mechanical workings of the car, the engine, drivetrain, anything like that, put them in crates, saved them off to the side. And then they put sandbags in some cars to make them heavier than others. So they all got to basically a uniform weight so that they could all move through the attraction at a ideal speed. So they thought, we'll find out that that didn't work quite well. After the fair, the cars were taken out, the motors and drivetrains were put in. A little plaque went on it that your car was used at the 64 New York World's Fair. And they were sold to Ford employees for an amazingly large discount. And it's kind of interesting. You would think getting a car with basically 0 miles on it, but had maybe 13 million people had sat in it. So they did do some refurbishing of the interiors. Things were going crazy at the Disney studios. They had all these shows going on. They were also in their regular business. They were making movies. They were making TV shows. They were doing all sorts of things. So all around the lot, you had the dinosaurs that they were building. Some of them were pretty big. The Brontosaurus, for example, filled the what we called the mill building at the time, totally there. And keep in mind, all these things had to be built in California, and then they had to be put on trucks and taken to New York. So Disney did a big marketing campaign about taking them out there and being seen. And this is the building they're going to end up in, the Ford Magic Skyway. Down below, they're building the Hall of Science, which is still there in New York today. But the Ford Magic Skyway, done by Welton Beckett Associates, basically you went into the round part at the bottom. It's called the Wonder Rotunda, and then you went into the main show building back behind it. And in building this, Walt had mentioned earlier, he'd gone out to the Seattle World's Fair and he realized a lot of the things that they had done right and other things they did wrong. This is a picture looking down from the Space Needle, and the geodesic dome at the left side is the Ford Pavilion from that fair. very small compared to the New York one. But look at that line of people waiting to go see it. It was a simulated space ride, and you could then see all the latest Ford models, cars, trucks, that sort of thing. But there was nothing to keep those people entertained. Luckily, Seattle doesn't get, you know, the super hot weather that New York got. But he was determined that he didn't want the crowd showing up at his show hot, bothered, mad. You know, he wanted them in a good mood. So he convinced Ford to fill up an area in the center here called the International Gardens. It really worked out well because people could come and they could look at all these intricately designed models that WED, it's now called Imagineering, designed. And they were built by a company, their specifications. And it showed all the countries around the world where Ford was selling cars. This also threw a bone to the Ford dealers around the world because Ford has put basically all their advertising money for several years into the 64 fair. And the people that were selling Fords in, say, Germany or France or anything, so what are you doing for me? Well, we're going to attract all the interest of people that are coming to the World's Fair to give them an idea of what you guys do in Germany or France or whatever. So they built these really interesting dioramas. They also built an exhibit upstairs, the Auto Parts Harmonic Orchestra, done by a fellow named Raleigh Crump, who, again, a great Disney artist and went to work over in Imagineering. And these musical instruments played, they didn't actually play, it was a pre-recorded soundtrack, but they moved in time to the music. So you can see a metronome up at the top of this conductor's podium. It was a windshield wiper. And everything in here is a car part of some part that Raleigh went and put together. So it was kind of a fun way just to entertain people on their way into the ride. And once you got up there, you got into your car. And you can date this as a very early picture because if you look at the license plate, there's a license plate for South Carolina. And that became a huge problem because people would come up and they'd wait on the line and they'd want to wait for the car from their state. Now, you know, if you were from, you know, New York, there were a lot of you, but, you know, there's only so many New York cars you can put on that that track. So they eventually had to decide real quickly, we can't have people for, you know, they tried it first. Okay, South Carolina, stand over here, North Carolina over there, everybody from Georgia to the light, folks from Pennsylvania to the left, finally just take off the plate and get into the car. Then this is where they debuted the Ford Mustang, and the Ford Mustang became a big hit, and everybody wanted to get into the Mustang for the first time in their life, and they eventually had to say, I'm sorry, you've just got to get in the first car that comes along. So it was again, things that you don't learn, you know, they sound good on paper to have all the 50 states celebrated with custom-made license plates didn't work too well. But off you went into the basically this time tunnel effect they had to go in the back. And I mentioned that the cars are supposed to go at certain speeds. Well, they found out that the Mustang was very light, so they put extra sandbags in it to try to get it to go faster, you know, down the hills and that. But if you're a car enthusiast, you'll notice a large silver bumper across the back of the car. That's because when they first were testing the ride, the heavier cars were coming down the hills a little too fast. They'd bang into the slower cars, and the car would have to go to the shop that night to get the damage fixed. The next day, they'd do it again. So Bob Gurr tells an interesting story how they realized at a certain point in time, they had to slow down the faster cars until they got the kinks out of the system. And the way they did it was they stationed Disney employees in the tunnel with baseball bats. He said, we basically bought out every baseball bat in the New York City area. And if they saw a car coming down the ramp too fast, they would run out and stick a baseball bat under the tire to slow it down and then pull it out when it was time to go again. So luckily they got that taken care of. But again, the things, you know, you work in something like Imagineering, things always work so well on paper. The real world, not always. So you go through it, you see the dinosaurs there, you know, different ones and different scenes. You also got to see some of the sketches we've seen before about the wheel. The narration talks about the first used car salesman. His wife's here, not real happy. She's doing all the work as he's selling stuff and saying goodbye to the people as he's leaving. And then we got into the interesting conundrum of tomorrow. We've taken you by the Ford car, and we've taken you back to the past. You obviously know what the present's about. But boy, the future is going to be wonderful, isn't it? And Ford's going to get you there. Well, one of the things, if you ever design a theme park, you realize is by the time you design the future and you build it, it's become outdated. So they didn't know what they were going to do for the future. They also spent so much money on dinosaurs and everything else that the future became a bunch of abstract plexiglass blocks with day-glow colors on them. And, great narration promising you that all the roads are going to move really fast. So you had little things like those red dots swooping through a tube to simulate a highway. So the future, we're not there yet. We'll never be. If you went to the fair, they gave out badges from each state. And it was done, again, for marketing purposes. Where are you from? So they could go back and tell all the people from South Dakota, yeah, we didn't give you much money for advertising, but we had 62 people here today or 109 people or whatever from your state. They also did a really kind of interesting thing. They made these badges glow in the dark. And they still glow today. If you get one of these old badges and put a flashlight on it and then walk in a dark room, they'll still glow. But why do they make them glow? It's because when the people rode through the Ford, the General Motors Futurama 2 Pavilion, all the GM Pavilion employees had to see all the Ford badges glowing in their pavilion. Kind of funny. Mention again, so a century of progress, Abraham Lincoln and Disney. Walt had loved Lincoln. He had been a huge exhibit at the 33 World's Fair. So he was thinking that, hey, maybe I can find a way to get Lincoln here at the 64 World's Fair. And he did. He convinced the state of Illinois to do it. He came up with the pavilion here for it. And the budget for it was too big. Illinois couldn't afford it. And Robert Moses had seen a demonstration. We're going to see some videos in a moment of early versions of Mr. Lincoln. That in a very rare moment of generosity by Moses, he agreed to split the budget with the state of Illinois to do the creation of the Lincoln figure. So Walt, we're going to see him. He's here pictured with the figure, but we're going to see some animation or some videos rather of just how much within 2 years they had advanced the technology of the Lincoln figure. So this movie starts, this is 1961, I believe, and this one particular one's silent, but the picture of Abe sitting in his chair, and if you look at his mouth is pretty much on-off, not doing a lot of subtle movements. He doesn't get up, he doesn't do anything, not even really tapping his fingers, and this was where they were limited to. They had the narration done by an actor called Royal Dano, and he had recorded a series of snippets, I guess you'd say, from different speeches. But this was to prove to the state of Illinois that they could have Mr. Lincoln. He was on time. He was on schedule. He was going to be there. And he blinks his eyes, and he still looks kind of robotic, I think we'd say. So we go into the next bit one. It's a little bit later, and we're going to see a greatly advanced Mr. Lincoln.
His prophetic words are as valid for our time as they were for his. And now, the skills of the sculptor and the talents of the artist will let us relive great moments with Mr. Lincoln. Never had a good definition of the word liberty.
So the mirror was there, by the way, so they could watch the figure of the movement, see how the clothes were draping, that sort of thing. But in 2 years, they had made some amazing difference. So Lincoln now goes to the World's Fair. They put him in place, and he immediately goes berserk. He starts flailing his arms, and these figures, if you've ever been near an audio animatronic figure, I mean, they look like a person, but they're machines. driven by hydraulics and gears, there's a definite safety zone you have to be careful about when you're around them. Mr. Lincoln would start smashing his chair to pieces and just going uncontrollably. And the guys, they were crazy. I mean, this thing worked perfectly. What happened? So they'd get him another chair. They'd put it all back together. He'd run fine 5, 6, 7, 8 times, and then he'd smash everything to pieces. And this drove him crazy, and it became so much of a problem that they had to announce Mr. Lincoln was not ready for the opening of the World's Fair. And they weren't sure they were ever going to get him ready for the World's Fair, because again, you know, you can't have the president, going berserk. And then finally, somebody found out what the cause of it was. Mentioned that the infrastructure had been left behind from the 1939 World's Fair. So we're using electric cables and sewer pipes and everything had been buried in the ground since 1939, not maintained. It had been spiffed up for 64, but there was a pavilion in the World's Fair called the Tower of Light. And it had a billion candle power beam of light that would shine into the sky. It was at the other end of the fairgrounds. But they realized that when they fired up the Tower of Light, it created electrical currents that came through the old wires, some of which had some water in them and stuff, sent off signals that interfered with Mr. Lincoln's controls, and he would go crazy. So they then said, okay, how do we buffer that? And they put some very big filters in the line system, ran it for a couple days in a row, no problem, and then they opened it up with great fanfare and success. It was so lifelike, and today we're looking at this in 2023 world eyes, where so many things are so different and lifelike today, but this was a huge thing that people would be convinced that the Abraham Lincoln figure was a real actor, and they couldn't possibly be a robot. There was a pavilion called SKF that gave out sample ball bearings, and kids would get a handful of ball bearings and take straws from a snack stand and start shooting BBs at the actor to try to get him to react. So they would periodically have to go out and pick BBs out of Mr. Lincoln's face. And, they finally convinced the SKF people, please don't keep giving out the ball bearings. It's not going real well. So Lincoln's a huge hit, 64. So they decided, okay, we're not going to rest on our laurels. The 65 is going to have an even better, even more improved version of Mr. Lincoln. And as long as we're building another 65 Lincoln, why don't we put Mr. Lincoln here at Main Street at Disneyland in the Opera House? So for the 1965 season, you had Mr. Lincoln making appearances on both coasts. If you've been to a Disney exhibit, whether it's the D23 or some of the other museum shows they do, they have the original Lincoln figure from the 64 fair on display. And they've got a plexiglass skin on it so you can see the inside of it. It's amazing what went in Mr. Lincoln. They then, of course, decided they would take this to Orlando, put it in the Hall of Presidents, and it's there today. They keep updating it with new presidents. And it almost came all the way back to Disneyland. We see Space Mountain where it is today. There's Main Street. And penciled in this one map is the Hall of Presidents show. They thought really a big thing about putting it in there. And what would finally have his salute to America inside here, you can see up there, it says Liberty Square. Again, they never quite got to it. But someday, the way things go, you never know what might show up. Now, Walt started also thinking, okay, I've got all these other people, and Monsanto didn't want to go to the World's Fair sponsor my dinosaurs or my history show or anything. How about Coca-Cola? They've been out here for years. They've got this really nice thing out of Coca-Cola, the refreshment corner. They sell a lot of hot dogs and Cokes. They would probably like to do a show at the World's Fair. So how would you like to take the Tiki Bird show? Now, Tiki Birds were pretty new at Disneyland. They were sponsored, by United Airlines at that time. But how would you like to go and sponsor the Tiki Birds, and we'll put your name on it? And this would be a win-win. I can do this really cheap because I already have all the models and everything. And Coca-Cola said, no, we don't want to have something that's already been done. We want something brand new. So Disney said, okay, great. We're going to come up with the Legends of the Enchanted Island. This was going to be a dinner show where you came in, sat down, and as before and during dinner, you'd have this whole big Polynesian show go on with dancers and that. But this was a part of the finale where the thunder gods and everything have to be appeased. lightning, the lava's coming down, everything is going crazy. The characters here are singing, dancing, live performers, and it was going to be a spectacular show. And Coke said, nah, we don't think anybody's going to be interested in that. We're going to come up with our own design. Thanks. So what did they do? And I like to joke about whoever came up with the Coke Pavilion, I wonder if they still were working at Coke a few months later. Because their whole thing was you would go through, walk through scenes of the world where Coca-Cola was sold, and they used what we call smellizer techniques, where you would go through Hong Kong and you would smell the smells of a Hong Kong fish market. If you went through the Alps or the jungle, you would get jungle smells or alpine smells. And again, you saw Coke being displayed. On the way out, you got to see bottles of Coca-Cola in different shapes and sizes that were sold around the world. Meanwhile, we're going to get the Small World, of course, which everybody remembers, but nobody remembers the Coke Pavilion. So again, imagine you could have had Walt Disney design that show for you, and you decided to simulate the smells of a Hong Kong fish market. Well, Walt also decided, I got this monorail. It's all built, it's all designed and everything. I could take that back to New York. That could be a great show. So he put together his master proposal on how the monorail would run all around the fairgrounds and would be left behind as a permanent attraction to the park to make it easier for park visitors to get around. So they did a big proposal. And if you're interested in this sort of thing, it's all on my site, the whole proposal you can download. Designed the stations, it was all set to go. And then he lost out to Greyhound, the bus company, because Greyhound was very, very determined to be the official transportation company of the World's Fair. They had been the official transportation company of the 33 World's Fair, the 39 World's Fair. They were not going to lose out for New York. So they operated a fleet of buses, trams, these little Greyhound little carts they called escorters. And they came up with the stipulation that nobody else could operate a monorail or any other system that carried people from one spot to another. So they ended up putting in the monorail, and it went from one spot right back to the same spot. So you couldn't get off at another station. It kept the contract alive. If you're a friend of The Simpsons, you can go watch the thing where The Simpsons got a monorail, and it self-destructs as it's running through town. And as it starts coming across, the sticker peels off, and you can see it was an old monorail from the 64 World's Fair. Again, he's going to think, I've got all these great ideas, I've paid money, I'm going to find a way to do it. Edison Square, General Electric, you would really like to go off and do something about how electricity has been so wonderful. So he came up with this idea that you'd walk through the street, and you have these exhibits you can see. It says the Gay 90s Square, he was going to call it. And you were going to go in and see, start in the house in Chicago, where they were first getting electricity, was first coming into the house, and then you'd go into a house a little more modern, and finally today. So they did all these sketches. We see Edison here with his light bulb and everything going on. And again, this was a walkthrough. And they started thinking about, that's a real problem. What do you do? If you've ever been to any place like an aquarium, and you know, you get there and somebody's gonna stand in front of you for 15 minutes as you're trying to see something, and it's going to be 182 people pushing in front of you and everything. So walking through this was not a good idea. And this is where they came up with a brilliant concept for the Carousel of Progress. And we're going to take more of a look at that great artwork that they did for it. So we're going to go and see modern life in all sorts of different times. This was circa 1958, Mickey Mouse Club. The kids are happily watching it. Not all the designs came through. This particular one was not put in, but we're going to see it through the eyes of Dad, our narrator. He's there at the turn of the century, and the stove is great if you fill it up with coal. Later on, you're going to have a modern GE electric stove and a modern GE everything. So we see him as he goes through the years, his faithful dog down there at the bottom, going through the 50s. And modern day, mom and dad enjoying all the wonders of the world. So great, great show. Still down at Disney World today, and the narration's been updated. It's a real must-see for me every time I hit Florida. And don't forget the song.
Walt was the great optimistic futurist.
He believed
when we wrote the song for the GE Pavilion, and that encapsulated his philosophy.
There's a great, big, beautiful
tomorrow.
We were asked by Walt to meet him and sing this song right after we wrote it to impress the GE people.
Well, it sounds pretty good. In fact, that's just the right spirit.
And he says, and when I tell you to leave, leave and just sort of trot off and do something.
It's a great film of the whole presentation Walt gave to GE executives. Now, if you've been to the Carousel of Progress Disneyland, or if you've been to it since it's been moved to Disney World, that was maybe all that you knew about it. But that was great. The GE had down below on the theater level all the things electricity can do for you. But if you go upstairs up this escalator, there's a lot more. There's going to be all sorts of GE things in here, and how GE is going to be getting the solar panels, GE jet engines, all sorts of things. And there was a show up there called the Sky Storm Spectacular. And you went in, they had this apparatus here that was going to demonstrate nuclear fusion, not nuclear fission, which blows things up, but nuclear fusion. And they had this big panel here that showing how that it was generating how much electricity and everything. And I always got a kick. They had, according to this day, 60,600 something successful experiments. And I always wonder what happened for the 780 something unsuccessful ones. Hopefully those people don't glow in the dark. Huge hit, huge hit. The lines for this were amazing. And the top of picture is 1964. There was a pavilion supposed to be built there. It didn't get built. They ran the line out and went through there. 65, they came up and put this covered area in there. And it was, again, a great marketing thing. It kept people out of the sun. They had fans in there, but they had TV monitors with commercials playing for GE products. So GE was just thrilled to spend the extra money to put that crowd control out there. But it was a huge hit, hard to put in perspective. They did a great thing. They built this figure of Grandma from the World's Fair, Walt posed for pictures, and they sent Grandma on a tour of the United States. They bought her her own airplane seat, her own train tickets. They sent her from city to city to city. And they had local celebrities, like here's Casey Stengel from the New York Mets. So he's glad to meet Grandma. And it just generated tremendous grassroots interest in the upcoming pavilion. Then we get to the final pavilion. And this is where Rolly Crump is remembering it. They had the three pavilions are going on nonstop. And then all of a sudden, Walt comes in. I've got this idea for a little boat ride. And this was kind of interesting. Walt, he was pretty much, you know, obviously in charge of the studio, but he delegated like everybody has to. And one day he's at a social event and he runs into Joan Crawford. And she says to him, it's too bad you couldn't build my pavilion for me at the World's Fair. And he said, what do you mean? What are you talking about? Well, Joan was on the board of directors of Pepsi, and they had agreed to put a pavilion at the World's Fair. And just like Ford, they had fired their designers several times over. And they already had the design for this building that he's resting his hands on, but they had nothing to put into it. So Joan had called over to Disney, and she got one of the Disney executives, and he said, oh, no, we're just too busy. Don't have time to do it. Don't even need to run it by Walt. Take my word for it. It's done. So Joan runs into Walt at this society affair, mentions it to him, and the next day Walt calls all the executives in, particularly the one in question, and made them all think about one thing, that the sign over the gate said Walt Disney Studios. And it didn't say, you know, I'll leave the guy's name out to be kind. And we're going to do this for Joan. So you think about something like Small World, which we all know today, it's in every Disney theme park around the world. If Joan hadn't gone to that same society thing and just happened to mention it to Walt, it wouldn't be there. So kind of amazing how a little incident in life can change all sorts of things off. This is Mary Blair. She was one of Walt's absolute design and color people that worked on so many of his feature films. Mary, a super, super talented artist, and she had just a wonderful eye for both color palette, but also for character design. And you look at some of the movies she worked on, you can really see her hand in it. But she had to come up with all these designs very, very, very quickly because again, it takes time to design them, but then it takes time to build it, and you have to have somebody making the costumes for them. The thing you could pull this off in less than a year. In today's corporate world, I mean, you couldn't even come up with the name of the pavilion in a year, let alone build this thing. Mark Davis, again, a great Disney animator, and he had been seconded over to Imagineering. He had come up with all sorts of things for the Jungle Cruise at the Disneyland. He came up with the idea of tying the children of the world together in musical things, that you'd have the children interacting with the animals, and just a wonderful design. And again, here's my warning. We're not going to get the, I hereby will not take any responsibility if everybody's singing this song later today. This was made for the Pepsi executives to show their other co-workers and employees what they were going to be doing. That's the Wed Workshop. It's Rolly Crump, designed the Tower of the Four Winds, and Mary Blair. And it's a doll. That's the Mary Blair doll that looks like her. We did walkthroughs, as I mentioned, just like with the cars. Where were you staying? How long were you to get this scene? And then they built the entire thing inside the sound stages in Burbank and filmed it here to use the TV show up there. And then the water, so the boat was on wheels and they were just pushing it through. If you've ever been inside the Snow World building, updating the show control system and stuff, you had to listen to the music for the better part of a couple of hours end to end. It's quite an experience. Gives an idea of what the scale is there. Then everything gets boxed up, bagged up, and taken off to New York. Global Van Lines being the official van line of Disneyland. So I got to have some synergy there. So he had the building we mentioned earlier was already designed, being built by Pepsi. They came up with something to fit inside it, but it was pretty much a warehouse type looking building. And he needed to come up with something that would draw your eyes away from it. So they put that colorful signage up, and then they came up with the Tower of the Four Winds. Rolly liked to make mobiles in his office. They would just spin around and everything. So he came up with different designs. Rolly is still with us, thankfully, and it was just a real out-of-the-box thinker. Walt saw that and said, how about if we build this mobile for the World's Fair? So they're there with the model on it in the left, and then they're out in the parking lot where they were testing it. Again, it was built in California, taken apart, and moved to New York. If you notice the one on the left, very thin structures of the arches going up holding the figures, and they're much thicker on the ones in reality. That's because this had to be designed to withstand hurricane force winds in New York. So the engineers decided that they would make the pipes thicker. Rolly hated it, and he was later instrumental in convincing Walt not to bring it back to the Disneyland. Which I like Rolly in a lot of things, but I wish he had not won that particular argument. It was a great design. And they brought the Disney characters back. Chipmunks there. Mickey Mouse had an unfortunate thing where a bunch of New York kids picked him up and chucked him in a lake. So while they would let the other characters go down, Mickey would only be seen upstairs in a safety area away from the crowds. So Chip and Dale, talking before the talk, I did Chip at Disneyland for a number of years, and it's fun to see that. This guy on the left with the pipe, he must have gotten asked a million times if he was Walt Disney. I mean, he's just happened to be a random guy going by as Goofy's here taking some fun with the kid, but sure looked like Walt. They had a VIP lounge up above. So if you are somebody that knew somebody, you got to go inside and have a free Pepsi. And then you had Snow White up there. And by this way things go, Disneyland was running the attractions back there. A fellow named Dick Nunes, if you're a Disney historian. He became the head of Disneyland and Walt Disney World, amazing guy. And Snow White became Mrs. Dick Nunes. So again, Mickey's up there for safety, and they were not going to let anything happen to him again. Did a TV show again with Synergy, aired on May 17th. They did a whole big thing of all the shows, where they were going to be, what you were going to see. And the shows were amazingly successful. But just like in 39, 40 fair, the fair ends. So the day after the fair ended, the fences went up to keep people out. Signs warning everybody we're going to be tearing everything down. And this was the Small World Pavilion about 3 months after the World's Fair closed. The day after the fair closed, the Small World boats were all put on trucks taken to New York. All those boxes we had seen earlier were taken back out of a warehouse. The characters were put in them, taken back out to Disneyland. Disneyland had the ability, though, to build a building of their own, not to fit within the Coke or the Pepsi environment, rather. So they added additional scenes to the version at Disneyland. So they decided, now let's move all the other stuff. So the four dinosaurs came out to the Disneyland. This was a visitor's guide that we would hand out to people explaining why we had dinosaurs in the administration building. My office at Disneyland was right behind the Tyrannosaurus Rex display. And at night, when the building was quiet and everybody else had gone home and I was working, it was very distracting to hear dinosaurs roaring through the wall. They brought the dinosaurs back and they didn't bring the rest of it. Walt had been very clever in his contract. He had no desire to turn that amount of square footage of Disneyland into an ad for Ford. So he didn't want the cars, didn't want the track. He got the right to all the dinosaurs, and Ford had to bear the responsibility for tearing down the building and all the ride stuff in New York. Carousel of Progress came out, was at the Disneyland for many years. When Disney World opened, GE said, hey, we think we've worn out our welcome with the West Coast. Would you please move it to the East Coast? They took it out there. It then became the America Sing Show, and today you can go and meet Star Wars characters in that. But again, we got a separate Small World building, the facade all designed by Raleigh Crump. They also brought back ideas. They didn't just bring back rides or attractions. They brought back concepts and ideas that they saw had worked well at the World's Fair. This was the Belt System Pavilion. You got these moving chairs and a conveyor belt that never stopped. And they had sound systems in it that would describe what you were seeing. The lady looks like she's having a great time. The guy doesn't seem so sure. But where have we seen things like that at Disneyland? Well, we have the Omni Movers, which go through the Haunted Mansion here. They're seen going through the Mighty Microscope. We have the People Mover up top. Down below, we have the ride control system from Spaceship Earth going through it. So the idea of moving vehicles with sound systems embedded in it. They also, wonder how much of a coincidence or how much subliminal it is, domes. We had the Perisphere being built over here in the 39 World's Fair, the Unisphere being built for the 64 World's Fair, and then down below, Spaceship Earth building for Walt Disney World. They also learned how not to build a theme park. Now, if you're from New York, you may have remembered a theme park called Freedom Land, had an ad campaign, Mommy, Daddy, take my hand, take me out to Freedom Land. And it was very much like Disneyland. You had the Main Street horse cars, you had a riverboat, you had a Frontierland. And it's no coincidence whatsoever, because a bunch of ex-Disney employees went off on their own and they helped design, build, and do Freedomland. But it showed Walt a couple things. One was that you cannot operate a theme park 12 months a year in New York because the weather is so god-awful in the winter. And I knew the guy that ran Freedomland. He and I worked on a theme park for Warner Brothers together. He said, you have to pay, you only have guests coming for 6 months of the year, but you got to pay security and property taxes and insurance for 12 months of the year. He also found out how strong, powerful, and expensive the New York unions were. So there had been some talk, was Walt going to build a permanent park in New York? They asked him, would he take over the World's Fair and keep it going and that? And he, that at this point in time, he had decided no for New York and had started his secret plans to start buying swamp land down in Florida. It was another World's Fair most people don't remember because, again, I mentioned that the BIE did not sanction the 64 World's Fair in New York. to kind of give Robert Moses back for all the time they insulted him. They sanctioned a World's Fair in Lucerne, Switzerland, and Walt made a trip over there to see it. Again, didn't have any exhibits or anything here, but he very interested, again, what shows, concepts, ideas, things that people are doing over there that might show up back in Disneyland in one of these days. There's a great shot here coming up in just a minute of him posing for pictures with some very, very lucky guests. There's Mrs. Disney going out with him. And you go and pose for a picture of yourself on a ship with Walt Disney. So that, unfortunately, comes near the end. Walt Disney died right after that, 66, so he was not there to see Expo 67 in person. But again, the concept of let's reuse other people's money. We had done America the Beautiful as a Circle Arma film. Let's do another Circle Vision film, but let's do one now on Canada. So that was part of the telephone system exhibit. Again, Maude Bell being the phone company exhibit. Back at Disneyland, the telephone company did the exhibit here in Montreal. They took the Auto Parts Harmonic Symphony Orchestra and made it more countryized and painted it in brighter colors and took it to Hemisphere 68 in San Antonio, Texas. They continued with the idea of Expo 67 had a round movie sponsored by the phone company. Well, why don't we do a round movie sponsored by the phone company for Expo 86 in Vancouver? And the thing comes back full circle. We're going to see a little bit more about Tomorrowland here.
Flushing Meadows, Corona Park, World's Fair. Don't forget your valuables and enjoy the future.
There's a great, big, beautiful tomorrow, shining at the end of every day. There's a great, big, beautiful tomorrow, and tomorrow's just a dream away. Man has a dream, and that's the start. He follows his dream with mind and heart. When it becomes a reality, it's a dream come true for you and me. So there's a great, big, beautiful tomorrow, just a dream away.
That was fun to work on. It was not shot anywhere at the World's Fair grounds. It was all done up in Canada. Green screen, CGI, all the stuff that Walt could only possibly dream about. I was a consultant to the look and design of that, and I found them those escorted vehicles that ran through there. So I need to find out here where my little screen went. It's probably in this other monitor that I have to go turn on in just 1 second so I can stop sharing. And then I'll be glad to see what questions or anything may have come through and see what I can do. So excuse me 1 second here. Is a control, oh, here it is, stop share. Okay, there we go. So any questions or anything that came in that I can then be more than glad to answer anything for anybody or do my best.
Well, first of all, thank you so much, Bill. That was a great, I guess, just reflection and just how much the World's Fairs were intertwined with Walt Disney. So first of all, I just want to ask a question. In all your research and such, do you have a favorite Disney object that just really sticks out to you?
Well, I like to joke. My favorite Disney object related to the World's Fair is my wife, because I went to the World's Fair that took me to Disney. I went to Disney, met my wife in a soundstage, but. Yeah, boy, a favorite object, that's really hard to think about. I've got so many things I've been collecting for so many years. It's funny, from the World's Fair in general, my favorite object of all things is a, looks like a cotton ball. I had gone to the World's Fair and I had never expected to ever get out of New York. And I was in the Egyptian pavilion and there was a woman working there. It was the final week of the World's Fair. And I was talking to her about how much she liked New York, and she was not looking forward to going home to Egypt, particularly the way women were being treated and are still being treated, but she wasn't happy about it. And I was saying, I'm sorry, can't you just stay? And she goes, no, I can't. And I was saying, well, you know, I hope you have memories of the fair. And kind of impulsively, there was a big display on the wall about industries in Egypt. And she pulled off a cotton ball, a piece of raw cotton, and said, well, here, I give you something. Think of me sometimes. So for all the tens of thousands of World's Fair things I have, I still have a little box with a little wad of cotton in it. And that just to me, you know, again, I luckily later had a job. I've got several million miles traveling the world. But that was that favorite thing. For favorite Disney one, you know, I tell you, you just around it so much, you're looking around my office and everything. It's, you know, I don't know which would be my favorite. It's like, which is your favorite kid, right? You know?
Yeah. And they probably all have different memories and different points within your career, I would imagine.
Yeah. You know, one of the things that was real interesting, I had worked at Disney. And then I got proverbially the offer not to be refused to go to Warner Brothers. I mean, a huge salary and everything else. And I was in New York, and just like how I ended up going to work for Disney, I had a day in New York where the meetings we were supposed to have all got canceled. Well, what am I going to do? You know, I'm from New York, so I've seen the Statue of Liberty. I've seen the Empire State Building. I decided I would get on a train, the number 7 train, and go out to the fairgrounds. And this was 1997 or something. I went out there and I just walked the fairgrounds, and I'm trying to remember in my mind where this was, where that was, or whatever. And I took a whole bunch of pictures, but I realized I didn't have a lot of my own pictures at that time. And the ones I took were really terrible. I was a terrible photographer, but I started thinking about maybe I could capture some of the memories. So I started putting ads in like magazines. If you have any pictures of the New York World's Fair, I'd like to buy them. And I started buying them. And now it's gotten out of hand. I have about, from the 64 World's Fair alone, I got about 32,000 pictures of it. But to me, that spark just went back, and I was 12 years old again. And I just started, you know, collecting and doing the history. And it was interesting, was when I first went to work for Disney and I had total access to the archives, I thought, oh, this would be great. I'll learn all about the World's Fair. And it turned out they had next to nothing, because the Disney studios cut all the deals and did all the financing and contracts. WED built all the shows and everything, and Disneyland staffed them and ran them. Then they took everything out back to the studio, California, and that fair was gone. Well, the folks at Disneyland assumed that everybody at the studio kept a copy of everything. The guy at the studio assumed everybody at WED kept a copy. So the entire Disney collection of stuff for the World's Fair was about 8 to 12 pages of stuff. And over the years, every time I get something, like they did a really neat newsletter for the Disney, for the Pepsi Pavilion, about who's coming to visit, and it's this birthday, and who's playing Mickey this month, and that sort of thing. As I get copies of those, I make copies and send them to the archives, so that when they were doing the movie Tomorrowland, it's going to be set. It's the built being done by Disney, going to be set at the World's Fair. You know, that's where the phone rang and they said, "Hey, could you help us make this movie?" So, you know, it's just fun how all things come together in different times and places.
Absolutely. Were there only 3 exhibits from the fair that were eventually brought to Disneyland?
No, they basically brought them all out, but they didn't bring out, for Ford, for example, they brought out just the dinosaur portion of it and left the caveman behind. They actually did bring the caveman here. They just repurposed into other things. So you had Illinois brought Mr. Lincoln. He was out here. You had the Carousel of Progress was brought out here. We had Pepsi brought back, Small World, and then the Ford Pavilion. So all 4 of them came back, but like I said, just part of the Ford Pavilion, not the whole thing. Oh, by the way, when Ford came back out here, I should have mentioned in the talk, they put Mr. Lincoln in the Ford Theater, the Main Street Theater, like I mentioned, and they get him all fired up, and he started smashing his chair to pieces. And they were like, what the hell? I mean, you know, what's he doing? There's no Tower of Light. And then somebody realized it was happening on a very regular schedule, and that's how often the monorail was going by, because it goes right past there. So they had to go and put a whole bunch of filters there so Mr. Lincoln stopped smashing chairs.
Oh my goodness. I mean, I can imagine that would be some sight, because it goes against everything you learn about President Lincoln, you know, as a child and such. So when the exhibitions or exhibits were brought over to Disneyland, I mean, I'm just assuming they were, I mean, much fanfare, very successful, well-received.
Yeah. And again, great publicity. Disney has always been great for publicity. So when they brought the dinosaurs in to Disneyland, you could have brought them in the easy way through the back, you know, thing. No, bring them in the front, get a big crane, take big pictures of it, you know, lifting the dinosaur over the monorail beam, make sure it's in all the newspapers. But there's a picture it shows all the time of the pirates being installed at Disneyland. And there's a movie of them going down the Santa Ana Freeway, you know, and they're all in the pirate costumes. Well, in reality, we would never, ever move an AA figure in full costume down the freeway. They would go in crates like you saw in that van line. Mm-hmm. But what's great for a movie? You put them in a truck and there's, you know, all half a dozen pirates standing there. And you drive it, and you drive it about 3 miles down the highway, turn around, go back to the studio, then take it, put it in crates and move it down there. But, you know, it's great on the news, you know, the tonight on Channel 5 News, and, you know, we've been invaded by the pirates. So I remember when we did the movie Pete's Dragon, and we had the a new edition of the Main Street Electrical Parade was a giant Pete's Dragon float. And I actually have the movies of it where, again, you just don't take it, put it on a truck and bring it down to Disneyland. No, let's take Elliot and let's drive him through the streets of Hollywood. And let's take him down, you know, and just basically drive through every town between Burbank and Anaheim that we can. And that's real logistics because you got to worry about where the light fixtures are and power lines and everything else. But boy, did people come out to see Elliot go drive them through the streets of Hollywood. You know, it's great to have fun with stuff like that.
Excellent. So here's another interesting question. After Walt Disney died, did staff from the company continue to go to World's Fairs? And where did ideas to update the park, or where did ideas to update the parks come from?
Yeah, the staff continued to go. You know, first of all, a lot of us just like to go to the things on our own and, you know, entertain. And then sometimes you go very much to see what the other guys did, because you know that they've done a movie, but have they done a certain technique to it? Have they done you know, something different? And you might like one little anecdote. Do you guys remember the National Lampoon's Family Vacation? They go out to Wally World. Mm-hmm. Well, I had left Disney at that time and I was working at Warner Brothers, and we had Wally World shirts for sale in our employee shop. So I bought a whole bunch of Wally World shirts. And a whole bunch of us from Disney, from Imagineering, went down to Disneyland that day, and we were all wearing Wally World shirts. And we're standing in line for the pirates, and this one lady was asking, what's Wally World? And we're saying, oh my God, it's the best theme park in the entire world. You've never heard of Wally World? She goes, no. I said, oh no. I said, everything you see here, it was all at Wally World beforehand. And she goes, I've never heard of it. And you're telling me Walt takes the ideas from Wally World? Or, oh yeah. Goes, I don't believe it. Well, a whole bunch of the guys take out their Disney ID cards and say, oh yeah. And the woman to this day is probably still looking for Wally World.
Oh, yeah,
we would go to things. And again, you know, you don't particularly go to steal anything. You know, we joke about stealing from Wally World, but it's really interesting to see, you know, what did somebody else do with a 3D movie? What did somebody else do with a interactive technology? And you don't want to steal from it, but you want to kind of figure out how do you do something similar, but how do you do it better? And I think that's one of the key things with Disney today is that, you know, like they just get the new attraction just opening at the Disneyland, the Mickey and Minnie Runaway Train. Mm-hmm. You know, it replaced an older exhibit down in Disney World, which I really liked, great movie ride. But things get dated. You know, we would put people on that ride and they'd go through with, and now in the scene from Alien, you know, Ripley in the Notre Dame, and kids today, what the hell is Alien? You know, I mean, it's not a big thing like it was when we built it. So you have to keep things going, keep them current and everything. And I think that's what you do, is you look at, you know, how did they do projection? How did they do sound? And I mentioned things like the smellerizers, whatever we want to call them, that Coke had done for the, you know, the fish market. Well, then when you go on soaring through California, you go through the orange groves and you smell that. We've used it for years. When you go through the dinosaurs, you smell, you know, sulfur and brimstone and that sort of thing. So you're always just trying to figure out, you know, how to how to up your show.
Yeah. And here's another question. What happened to the Monsanto House of the Future? That was a promising concept for future housing.
Yeah, a friend of mine is actually writing a book on it. I think he's hoping to have it out late this year. And it was an interesting concept. The whole idea was plastics. You can mold them, shape them. And the idea was you'd have a factory that would make all the plastic pieces. You'd truck them out to a site where somebody put a pre-built foundation, bolt a house together, and off you'd go. Well, they realized in trying to market this that people, like that house that they built was a small one. I think it had 2 bedrooms or something like in it. But how big can you go? And then do you really want to live in a community where every house is exactly the same? And then how do you then ever modify it, enlarge it? I actually live near a tract of homes here called the Eichler community. And this fellow Eichler was like a very well-known architect, but he was like Franklin Lloyd Wright. He liked to design his own front door, his own windows. So if you live in an Eichler home and you want to get a front door, you can't just go to Home Depot because nobody sells Eichler-sized doors. They started realizing that was the problem with the House of Tomorrow was, you know, that if everything had to come from Monsanto, you didn't have any options. So eventually they decided to take it down. And their concept was that they would come in and just bring in a big ball on the end of a chain, like you see smacking down buildings in New York or something all the time. So they brought in the ball and it swung over it and bounced off it. And they brought in a bigger ball and it bounced off it. And they realized they weren't going to be able to get it down. So they had to come in with chainsaws and start cutting lines and sections out of the thing and come up with big, Dave has pictures of this in the book. I've got pictures too of just giant claws ripping it to shreds. Then they finally got down to the basement, or it didn't have really a basement, it had a foundation that was built so massively to handle it that it's still there today, covered up in plants, and it's like Ariel's grotto or something, that you know, there's still remnants if you know where to look. Yeah, there's a house of the future. But yeah, evidently when that wrecking ball bounced off, people were quite astonished. And Monsanto was quite proud of it, that the house was indestructible.
Oh, excellent story. We have another question. And the student writes, I always thought of Disneyland as a leading edge in line control, even to this day. Does this work still continue? And then you have a hit now. How do we make it accessible? Because you mentioned that with the pavilion, and then they added like the garden and that symphony to entertain people in line. How much of a consideration is that?
Oh, it's a big consideration. Disney started really excelling at it when they opened up Pirates of the Caribbean, the lines for that got to be huge. And if you go there today, that whole area they have with the walkway and everything is totally different. It was just, you know, people outside. And between Pirates and the Swiss Family Robinson, there's a whole queue area that's used a lot now. Back, you know, in the days when I worked there, some days it was open, some days not. But the whole concept was if you see a line that goes from here to eternity, you're not going to want to get on it. And by the time you get to it, you're going to be mad that you're on it that whole time. But if you only see 10 to 12 feet, and I forget what the optimum number that some guy calculated, 27.2 or something. But if you go there and then you make a turn, your brain registers that you've made progress. You go ahead, you make another turn, progress. So your brain is always interacting progress. So we did that with putting the lines in, and then you start coming up with how do you make the lines interesting? So like for Indiana Jones, you've got this big long line, but part of it's outside and you go through and there's a Jeep and all these artifacts and everything. And you get inside and it's the thing, don't tug in this rope when you do, things happen. So you keep all sorts of interaction going. The only time I can think that we ever really blew it and was we were building Epcot. And a lot of the pavilions, they had big pre-show areas, but I was arguing with people that we were not doing enough for the lines for Epcot. And people were convinced, oh no, it's such a big facility, it's gonna be handled everybody. Well, we opened Epcot and the first week of it was just wow, because everybody was down there and we filled up all the pre-show areas. And sorry, my dog is going crazy, 1 second.
No problem. That's the world we live.
The perils of Zoom.
Yes, exactly.
Everybody's mobbing around, like say the energy pavilion. You got 400 people all trying to get through a door. And we were also having our share of breakdowns of technologies. So people get into the energy pavilion. Sorry, it's not working. Go back out, come back. And within a week, we had guys with concrete saws drilling holes in the ground to put barriers up, to put up the barricades to keep, you know, people marching around. But you try to make the whole pre-show as interesting as possible. I just mentioned that the Mickey and Minnie thing that's just opening in Toontown.
Mm-hmm.
Huge pre-show area to keep you entertained. And it actually becomes interesting. And sometimes people will start complaining that the pre-show is so interesting that they are missing part of it. So, you know, can they go slower and the people behind them want to go faster? If you go, for example, to Florida and you go to the competitors over to Universal, you can buy a VIP pass to go to the front of all the lines. If you do that for the Harry Potter ride, you miss a tremendous amount of pre-show, which is done, you know, to keep the people entertained. They put some of it in the VIP pre-show area, but in some cases, you really want to go through the pre-show stuff because it's so cool to see what's, you know, going on there. And then you get into the main attraction, and it becomes one giant immersive experience.
Excellent. Well, did you ever have the opportunity to meet Walt Disney or other members of his family?
No, I never met Walt. Well, Walt died in 66, and I started with the company in 76.
Hmm.
But I got to know his daughter well. I had written my book on the history of Disney television, and the Disney family was interested in doing a CD-ROM biography on Walt, and they asked if I would do the TV section of it. So I wrote it, and it was a fun project to do, but we had the debut at the Lincoln Theater, and it was a special ticket event down at Disneyland. So, you know, open up the curtain, there's Mr. Lincoln sitting there sleeping in his chair, and the rest of us out talking. And we were talking about Walt, and I was asked my impressions of Walt, and I was saying, look, I never met him. I you know, knew all sorts of people. I interviewed, his speech writers and everything else. But I said, Walt struck me as my Uncle Tom. My Uncle Tom had a great train set in the basement of his house. And we'd go over there at Christmas or Thanksgiving, and we'd all be down with the train, and the woman would be upstairs yelling, you know, get up here and eat this dinner now, or you're not eating today. And I said, you know, I was really torn. I really wanted the great turkey dinner, but I also wanted to see Uncle Tom's train set. And I said, it struck me with Walt, I really liked a lot of the shows that he did, like The Scarecrow, Romney Marsh is a great period piece. Merlin Jones, he did all these great things, but I wasn't so crazy about The Boy and His Aardvark, The Boy and His Anteater, The Boy, you know, he did all these animal things. My dad loved him, I didn't, but I sat there faithfully watched it because I didn't want to let Uncle Walt down by not watching his show. Well, after the thing was over, Diane Disney came over and said that was one of the nicest things anybody had ever said about her father. Would I like to work on other projects with the Disney family? So I was able to work on the design of the Disney Family Museum up in San Francisco.
Oh, good. Yes. Yeah, I was just going to ask you about that.
Yeah, it was, you know, you had the empty building. We went up there and we were at the hotel. And my kids aren't very easily impressed. But when Diane Disney came to our hotel to pick us up, the driver over there, they thought that was pretty cool. So, yeah. And then, you know, I was in touch with her and then Ron Miller until they both unfortunately passed away. And since then, like Joanne Miller, you know, a bunch of the kids worked at the studio in things like the mailroom. And lower level jobs, their parents were pretty smart. They didn't want to just bring him in and say, hey, I'm making you a producer or something. Walt had worked his way up. Ron had worked his way up. So the kids had their jobs in the mailroom or traffic messengers and that. And you get to know them, and they were very friendly and very approachable. I mean, normal people. And I say that because so many people in Hollywood are not normal. I mean, just not. The Disney family, you know, I got to know Roy Disney, not the Roy's brother, Walt's brother, I get his nephew. I got to know him. And it was just, again, from a kid out of Brooklyn, and these are all the guys that created the things I adored as a kid. I was just.
I was going to say, and for those of you who haven't been to the Family Museum up at the Presidio, please go. One thing I really loved when I went through that museum is how in every aspect, you had a section about the family. And I thought that was just a great story. You get like both sides of the story throughout your experience there.
Yeah, I think it's really well done. And, you know, I didn't know Walt, but I knew an awful lot of the people that did. And, when I was doing the TV book, I talked to a speechwriter, for example, and Walt had the problem saying the word aluminum. He always mispronounced, for whatever reason, he always mispronounced aluminum, which was a real problem because Reynolds Aluminum was one of his sponsors. So this fellow Jack Spears one day wrote a script for Walt that he put in every word that he knew Walt couldn't say, and he just put it in there. And Walt didn't study these things a lot. He basically went out to this, they created his office on a stage. It wasn't his real office, but he would get through it, and he got halfway into this and just got tongue-tied and exploded, how am I supposed to say this? And Jack said, well, I have another one. He'd done it as a joke, and he was going to tell Walt. He said he never, ever owned up to it. And I'd love to find the footage if that existed of Walt, because he said, boy, he had steam coming out of his ears that day.
Wow. Yeah. Well, here's an interesting question, too, kind of like as we're ending our time together. And then also for the class, check out Bill's website that's in our Canvas shell on the World's Fairest Photos. There you can get information about his books that he's written about the World's Fairs. And then we actually have someone, Bill, who worked at the expo in Texas.
Hemisphere.
Yes, and so was mentioning that. But I'm also going to put in real quickly here in the chat for those of you that want to check out his other website that, again, gives you more of his resources for you, BillCotter.com. But somebody asked an interesting question, and do you think Disney would approve, or what would he have thought about how expensive tickets to a Disney park, because I think they're all very expensive, have become?
Yeah, it's an interesting question. You know, you always get people, what would Walt do or say? And, you know, we don't know. I mean, would he like the park today or not like the park today? And there's no question the parks are expensive. But I always try to put in relation to compared to what, you know, I mean, if you go to a Broadway play, they're not cheap. I mean, you know, you get one of these big tickets, you know, when all of a sudden Hamilton came to Broadway, people are paying, you know, $500, $800 for a ticket or something. And okay, so now, you know, Disneyland, and I don't pay a lot of attention to the price because I can go for free, but I mean, say it's $135, make that some number. You're getting from the time you get there to the time you leave with all the shows, the fireworks and everything else. So you divide it by hour. It's how much are you spending per hour? Okay. If you go, and I had season tickets for years for the Dodgers, you know, wow, you know, what they cost now. And again, if you go to a game, the game lasts 3 hours. How much are you paying by hour? So, you know, if you wanted to go to Disneyland for the same amount of time for 3 hours, they used to have a thing at night where you could buy a discount ticket, right, just going at night, but now it's so crowded that wouldn't work. But if you really take it down to, you know, how much you're paying per hour for the experience, I think that's something that a lot of people don't think about. I mean, again, if you're going and you've got to buy, you know, tickets for yourself and your two kids, and you got to pay, I think they're charging something like $10,000 to park or something these days. But I mean, the whole thing gets to be really expensive.
Right.
But if you put it in perspective, again, I don't think Walt ever intended that you go there every weekend and spend your money. You know, I mean, when he was taking his kids out to the park, you know, the Griffith Park to the merry-go-round or something, he didn't go every single weekend, because if you do something every single weekend, the magic kind of wears off, right? Yeah. So I think today you've got, to me personally, I'm kind of against the season passes, because I think so many people get the season pass, they go and they go and they go, and they're so expensive, you have to keep going, you got to keep getting that value. To me, yeah, it's expensive, and the price of the food and everything, you know, but again, I try to put it in perspective. If I do this once a year, and this is my big blowout, I'm taking the family and I budget for it, how much am I getting per hour? And again, if I'm there, you get there 8 a.m. and you're leaving at 1 a.m. or something, you know, that's a lot better than a Broadway play there for 2 hours and you're out the door.
Very good perspective. I never thought about it that way. In that regard, it makes sense. Well, Bill, I want to thank you again for all that you shared. We had lots of comments about great trips down memory lane for lots of our students, both in New York, going to World's Fairs. Somebody even went to Disneyland, remembers when they went in 1960. And so thank you so much for that. Again, you can carry on the discussion and your impressions through the activities in Canvas, and I would highly encourage that. Check out Bill's websites as well, and to get more information. And Bill, if somebody wants a signed copy of one of your books, what would be a good way to do that?
You can go to BillCotter.com, which would lead you also over to WorldsFairPhotos.com. You can order them from me, and I'd be more than glad to sign it and inscribe it anybody wants. And if anybody just, you know, did go to the World's Fair, or if you have any questions or anything I can answer, like for the 64 World's Fair, I have every pavilion on it. Some of the other World's Fairs list, so I've just got a certain amount of time. If you're also into Zorro, I got a huge thing on that on my website. But anybody has any questions or anything, you know, just send me an email, and I try to be fairly responsive in getting back to people. But, you know, again, the World's Fair was a big thing for me. I walked through that gate at 12 years old, and I never thought, you don't stop thinking. I'm 12 years old, and my first thought was, did I have enough money to buy a hot dog today, right? Well, you know, the event of all the things you do end up, you know, changing your career and how you go and you do things and everything. And I was lucky. When I worked for Warner Brothers, I traveled around the world, and I was able to go to a whole bunch of World's Fairs and, have a great time, see a lot of different shows. But, I thoroughly encourage anybody, you know, that's interested in any of this stuff, reach out. If there's a particular fair that you were at or a pavilion that you remember, and I don't have a picture on my website, I'll be glad to try to dredge something up out of the archives for you.
All right. Well, thank you. And that's very generous offer. So again, thank you all for staying and coming today, and have a great week. And we'll see you all next Friday, where we will learn about the evolution of sound technology in movies. So, and tell the dogs goodbye as well.
The dogs are at it again.
Exactly. All right. Have a great day, everyone. We'll see you next time.
Thank you.
Thank you, Bob.